Empedocles, mysterious magician, miracle-working doctor, deified philosopher. This is how the sources describe the philosopher we're gonna cover today. So double wrap your toga around your waist, tighten your bronze sandals, and let's go. Hello and welcome back to the Epicurean Stoic and the series where we track the progress of philosophy in ancient Greece from its birth in Ionia down to Epicureanism and Stoicism. So far, we've covered the Milesians Thales, Anaximander and Anaximenes, then Heraclitus of Ephesus, before traveling west to southern Italy where Parmenides and his students the Elearics were based. In the timeline, we're here, with Melissus and Zeno of Elea giving their arguments and paradoxes. There is only one being, which is eternal, spatially infinite, immovable, and unchangeable. All the plurality, the great number of different things we see, the constant motion and change of everything around us, it's all an illusion, they said, and they had their logical arguments behind them. It is in this climate that the theories proposed by Empedocles were formed. Empedocles was the first Sicilian-born philosopher we're covering in this series, as he came from the city of Acragas. He disagreed with the Milesians about the existence of a protearchy, but did not share the monism of Heraclitus or the Elearics either. At the same time, he quite liked Anaximander's pairs of opposites, hot-cold and dry-wet. When it comes to Heraclitus versus Parmenides, he agreed with Heraclitus that change and motion are indeed constant and perpetual, while also agreeing with Parmenides and the Elearics that being is ungenerated, indestructible and eternal, and that void, which is non-being, does not exist. Wait, what? How could he accept all of these things? They seem mutually exclusive. Well, here lies the genius of Empedocles. And by here, I don't mean Mount Etna, the volcano where he allegedly threw himself in. No, I mean here in this philosophical impasse. How did he manage to reconcile these two opposing views? I think it is with Empedocles that we see for the first time the phenomenon that is most common in today's academic philosophy. The strategic modification of a theory or combination of elements from numerous theories in order to solve problems such as, in this case, the incompatibility of two key insights. Empedocles accepts change and motion without accepting that the variety of different tangible objects we see around us is the ultimate reality. At the same time, he keeps all the Elearic insights mentioned above without accepting that being is one or immobile. Yes, Empedocles went full plurality on his contemporary Elearics by attributing the features of being they liked to not one, not two, but four roots of all things. As we've seen in a previous video, Anaximenes had talked a bit about how air becomes fire, water, or earth, while the Pythagoreans and Heraclitus had also mentioned these four elements. But Empedocles consciously posits them and only them as the true beings, what the world is ultimately made of: earth, fire, water, and air. How do these elements form everything we see around us then? The Milesians had, of course, provided their answers to this question, albeit with only one element to play with, and Empedocles sure made use of the fact that he had four. While the elements themselves are eternal, unchanging, and also equal to each other quantitatively, it is the mingling and separation of the elements, their combination in different quantities, that constantly creates the different observed substances and objects. So, with this ingenious move, Empedocles single-handedly avoids Parmenides' problem of explaining why we are supposedly fooled into thinking that objects change and move around us. Our empirical reality of motion and change, plurality, coming to be and perishing, is neatly explained at a fundamental level by the existence of the four elements and their combinations. From there, some elaborations were given, like for example, that blood is made of equal parts earth, fire, water, and air. If you laughed at how funny this sounds, just think of how ridiculous the corresponding elaboration on the constitution of water as two parts exploding gas and one part combustible gas would have seemed to anyone before the likes of Dalton, Cavendish and Lavoisier. More importantly, Empedocles was the first to say what these scientists restated as the foundation of chemistry: matter is not created or destroyed, only transformed. When the roots combine to form animals or plants, men say these are born, and when the roots scatter again, men call it death, wrongly. Impressive stuff so far. Empedocles needs to answer one key question though. Motion was considered impossible by the Elearics because it presupposes either void or another being, things they rejected. And now with Empedocles' four elements, motion is possible, but only possible. How and why is it that the four roots move? Again, his answer is very powerful and helpful in its simplicity. Forces. Empedocles introduces for the first time the concept of an immaterial force acting on matter. this becomes an exterior cause for motion in contrast to the autokinetic property that Thales attributed to all matter and equated with soul. Specifically, Empedocles posited two forces, another pair of opposites, attraction, repulsion. One is love and the other is strife. Love combines things into one and strife breaks them apart. Following Anaximander, Empedocles claimed that these two opposites are in perpetual struggle, giving the universe a cyclical nature. On one extreme, there's the point when love prevails everywhere, when everything becomes one, a unity, a sphere. On the other extreme, there's pure plurality, where the elements are completely separated by strife. It's in between these two that all the different combinations of the four elements exist, and this is the temporal point of the universe that we call our time. On a side note, Empedocles claimed that these combinations of the elements gradually formed parts of things, limbs, which were wandering, still, quote-unquote, solitary members, in a very crude, almost comical version of evolution. He talked of heads without necks roaming the earth, and then combining with other random parts, forming chimeras with, for example, human bodies and heads of oxen and vice versa. Claiming that this is some kind of precursor of Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection might seem tenuous, but Empedocles did say that all the parts that were assembled with one another in such a way as to be capable of surviving became animals and continued to exist. Again, that's quite impressive, especially if you think that practically nobody believed something like this until Darwin came, even if Empedocles' view lacks the long-term, grander scope of Darwin's theory. And as if chemistry and biology weren't enough, Empedocles also gave us correct claims about astronomy, such as that the moon takes its light from the sun, and that a solar eclipse is caused by the moon being in between the sun and the earth, blocking the former's rays and casting a dark shadow on the latter. Anyway, back to the forces. Just like Heraclitus' logos, Empedocles' love and strife, together with his four elements, play a key role in more than cosmology and metaphysics. He says that the sensation of pleasure is caused by what is similar in terms of parts and their mixture, and that of pain by the opposite, which means that he used the microcosm-macrocosm, or human world move that Anaximenes had introduced in a very novel way. The very specific, exact combination of the four elements that each of us is made of is some form of chemical signature, and if we are surrounded by things that have a similar chemical signature, then due to the attractive force of love, we feel pleasure. If the opposite happens, we feel pain. Taking it further, it is not only sensations and mental capacities like feelings that Empedocles categorized as fully corporeal, given his metaphysics. Cognitive capacities such as thinking and knowledge forming also follow the same route, as like is not only perceived by like, but also possible to be known by like. As we said earlier, Empedocles veered away from the rationalism of Parmenides and did not share his views on how the senses are fooling us, but he also realized the limits of his empiricism. "For narrow are the resources spread out along the limbs," he said, urging us to keep changing our character and using previous observations and beliefs to extend our knowledge of the world. Interestingly, just as Thales had shown more than 100 years before Empedocles that the knowledge achieved through reasoned observation of nature can be used in our interest, Empedocles also made sure to point out how important this aspect of knowledge is. For him, knowledge is not just about discovering the truth, but also the tool for mastering nature and her powers, improving the human standard of living in the process. Finally, we have ethics. For Empedocles, love brings concord, while strife brings, well, strife. So apart from the natural aspect of their usefulness, the pair of forces also have a moral aspect. As Aristotle noted, Empedocles suggests that love is truly the cause of good and strife the cause of evil, and with his very short maxim, fast or abstain from evil, he urges us to avoid strife and think of how all the disparate individuals that a society is made of can coexist and cooperate in a harmonious, loving way. So again, the introduction of a concept such as that of the two opposing forces has immense ramifications for Empedocles' worldview, not just in cosmological discussions, but also discussions on epistemology and ethics. In fact, Empedocles was one of the last figures, definitely the last pre-Socratic, to unite all aspects of theorizing, including the world-focused cosmology and metaphysics, the human-centered ethics, as well as epistemology, where the relation of humans and the world is analyzed. He made the simple move of attributing most properties of the eleatic single being to a plurality of first principles, his four elements of earth, fire, water, and air, and he posited the pair of forces love and strife, attraction and repulsion, to explain not just what the world is made of and how it came to be as it is, but also how human societies can function, and how we, as fallible human beings, can come to the position of knowledge about the world around us. This elegant unification, something that only Heraclitus had done so well before him, is definitely one of his greatest achievements, only to be matched by his quote-unquote scientific claims, which would be confirmed as either findings or fundamental intuitions and reasonings behind the revolutions in the various sciences some 2 millennia after him. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, press like and subscribe to my channel. I'll see you in the next one, which will be about the atomists. So until then, have a great day. Don't wear bronze sandals if you're planning on jumping into an active volcano to pretend you're a god, because the sandals might be thrown back out and show that you're a fraud. And as always, seek virtue.